The year is 1871, just 6 years after the Civil War. Ulysses S. Grant is president. The West is far from being won as skirmishes between Indian warriors and the U.S. cavalry continue to build toward all-out war. The American Industrial Revolution is underway. P.T. Barnum launches the greatest show on earth, and on November 9th, in the tiny frontier town of Central City, Colorado, a baby girl is born. Her parents, George and Serena Sabin, name her Florence, and she will grow up to do things women in America had never before even dared dream of doing. Young Florence's life changed forever when she was 7 years old. Her mother died, and she and her sister were sent to live with relatives in Chicago. Summers, however, were spent with grandparents in Vermont, and that led to prep school and Smith College, where Florence majored in zoology, receiving a B.S. degree in 1893. While at Smith, Sabin had been encouraged to study medicine at the new co-ed medical school at Johns Hopkins. Florence Sabin entered Johns Hopkins School of Medicine in 1896, one of 14 women in a class of 45. Her skill and originality in laboratory classes caught the eye of noted anatomist Franklin Moll, who became her mentor and role model, and it was Moll who convinced her to concentrate on pure science, suggesting two projects that would help establish her reputation among researchers. One was a three-dimensional model of a newborn baby's brainstem, which became the basis of a widely used textbook called An Atlas of the Medulla and Midbrain, published in 1901. The other project was an investigation of the embryological development of the lymphatic system. At the turn of the century, Johns Hopkins refused to hire females to the medical school faculty. But Sabin's work on the lymphatic system was so outstanding and received so much praise from colleagues that the Hopkins trustees made an exception in her case. And in 1902, Florence Sabin became the first woman faculty member at Johns Hopkins, teaching embryology and histology in the Department of Anatomy. She was promoted to associate professor in 1905, and 12 years later became the first woman to hold the rank of full professor at Johns Hopkins. During her years at Hopkins, Dr. Sabin became a legendary teacher, combining intellectual discipline with warmth and a willingness to engage her students on many levels. In 1921, the Rockefeller Foundation invited her to China to speak at the opening of its Peking Union Medical College. In 1924, the American Association of Anatomists elected her its first woman president. And the following year, Dr. Sabin became the first woman elected to membership in the National Academy of Sciences. At Hopkins, Dr. Sabin grew increasingly dissatisfied with dividing her time between teaching and research. So when Simon Flexner, director of the Rockefeller Institute for Medical Research, suggested that she consider joining the Institute's staff as head of the newly created Department of Cellular Studies, Sabin was intrigued. She knew that Flexner admired her work, so she accepted the offer on the condition that salaries also be provided for several of her Hopkins lab colleagues. Florence Sabin moved to New York and began her work at the Rockefeller Institute in the fall of 1925. It was the perfect opportunity to further her exploration of how monocytes and other white blood cells defend the body against infection. She and her team became part of a massive study being conducted by the National Tuberculosis Association. And inspired by what was learned there, Dr. Sabin fine-tuned her research investigating how antibodies are formed in response to foreign substances. In 1931, at the pinnacle of her 13-year stint at the Rockefeller Institute, a Good Housekeeping magazine poll named her one of America's 12 most eminent living women. Those years in New York were especially stimulating for Florence Sabin. Letters to her sister reveal a constant whirlwind of social and work-related activity. But by 1938, Dr. Sabin decided it was time to retire. She returned to her childhood roots in Colorado. Retirement was pretty quiet until 1944, when it was suggested that Colorado's governor appoint Dr. Sabin to his new Committee on Health. Over the next 2 years, Sabin found that Colorado's morbidity and mortality rates were unacceptably high, and its public health infrastructure was antiquated and unacceptably poor. So the Sabin Committee drafted public health bills to remedy the situation, and Sabin herself traveled around the state drumming up public support for new health legislation. In 1947, the Colorado legislature passed four so-called Sabin bills. Then Dr. Sabin became manager of Denver's Department of Health and Charities, and she organized a massive program of chest x-rays to identify cases of tuberculosis and other lung diseases. In 1951, Dr. Sabin received the Lasker Foundation's Public Service Award for her work in public health administration. And by then, she was again ready to retire, turning her attention to caring for her ailing sister. The strain of that, however, eventually took a toll on her own health, and a bout with pneumonia put Dr. Sabin in the hospital. She recovered enough to return home, but several months later, on October 3, 1953, Florence Sabin quietly passed away. Florence Sabin was a pioneer, literally and figuratively. In fact, Sabin established such an awe-inspiring legacy in the world of medical science and in the realm of public health in her native Colorado that the state honored her with this statue that stands in the National Statuary Hall of the U.S. Capitol.